Those of you who've been around a while, you guys know the Gillilands. Todd has been coming here off and on for a long time. Way back when we were in the filling station as a sanctuary, Todd would come with his mom and dad and his sister, and they would sing and lead music for our revivals when he was this high. And Todd has seen some exciting things happen that God is doing in Uganda. And he's been there for, I think, Todd and Wendy. Wendy, I didn't mean to leave you out. Wendy's here too. She's a Gilliland by marriage. And we're sorry. But it's okay. The whole package comes. When you marry the guy, you marry the family, right? Anyway, I'll move on. Shut up, Cooper. So Todd is here to share, and when we dismiss, they're going to be out at their display table. So answer any questions, whatever you have that you want to talk over with them, pray with them, whatever. They will be there when we dismiss. So before I turn the microphone over to Todd, they have, I pray, a video that will introduce you to FNC Ministries.
God is good.
Yeah. Hi.
Hi.
Good morning. My name is Todd, and I am a Gilliland. Guilty. Yeah. Just want to see you. That's okay, just for a minute. Yeah. Thanks for... thank you, church. Thank you, leaders, pastors, elders, for allowing us to come and share about what God's doing in a little place called FNC. It stands for Faithfully Nurturing Children. And this morning, I just want to share with you what's going on there, if that's okay. And to do that, one of the ways I want to do it is by looking into 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 34 through 37. Again, that's 1 Samuel 17, 34 through 37. The title of this message today is Remember the Lion and the Bear. Remember the Lion and the Bear. For most of us, or at least some of us, it seems our past helps us with our future. It helps us make decisions. It gives us perspective and hopefully an ability to make better choices, which can ultimately lead to better results and a better life. And I believe this is true whether you know Jesus or you don't. But what about those of us who've made the choice to believe that Jesus is who he claimed he was and he still is? The Son of God, the way, the truth, the life, the great I am. For me, it's less about a better life. When Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me, or the last shall be first and the first shall be last, and my personal favorite, for whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life will find it. So why do so many of us have a hard time living this day in and day out? When I remember and I look back on my life, if I'm honest, I've lived more seconds, minutes, hours, and days for self and not for Jesus. I've often put my desires, ministry, and others before my family. I had the distinct privilege of holding a doctorate in making poor choices. I am a professional sinner. That said, I follow not only a professional sin remover, but the God of the universe who loves me as I am and not as I should be. And when I remember the sacrifice Jesus made for me and all of mankind, I'm reminded I'm saved by a love which covers a multitude of mistakes. And thank God. Since the fall of 2012, myself, my wife, and my three daughters, we've continued to make the choice to follow Jesus and the work he's doing on the other side of the globe with a little school called FNC Academy. Faithfully Nurturing Children. It began with a letter written by a little girl named Christine. I often remember her letter and often wonder if she handed it to the right person. But when the letter begins with Dear Teacher Wendy, and your wife's name is Wendy, chances are good it's yours. When we began with 23 students, 6 staff members in a prayer. Hope for the Hopeless was our mission statement. And what I didn't know at the time was just how much God wanted to fill us with the hope, just as much as he did the children. And as we've entered into 2020, God turned a meager prayer into a plantation of hope. Today, FNC provides hope to 240 children and more than 50 full-time staff members. Amen. We have 2 campuses, one of which we continue to lease and another which we own, which is 13 plus acres currently used for our older grades for boarding school. FNC also has a boys and girls home which provides 24/7 care to both boys and girls whose family lives were one time in jeopardy. We recently, as of June of 2019, opened 2 medical clinics, one in each of our 2 campuses, but he isn't stopping there. In February of 2019, FNC partnered with EMI, Engineering Ministries International, to begin the process of planning and creating the plans required to build the future of FNC. It was an exciting moment for all. But then the dreaded numbers came. The cost of the project. Have you been there? The questions came to me like a rushing flood, and this is what they were. Is this at all possible? How would we even begin? What would people's reactions be? God, are you sure? And without even realizing it, the questions became statements like, this can't be done. I've bitten off more than I can chew. I've failed. You're not strong or wise enough to pull this off. Some time had passed and the doubts began to become facts in my mind like freshly poured concrete, and they began to harden my heart, and maybe you've been there before. And then, just at the right time, God sent me a word, not from the heavens, but from a wonderful podcast. And by the way, when I moved to Uganda, I didn't even know what podcast was. The podcast was called Remember the Lion and the Bear. And since I was a little kid, and Rod told you that, I guess you've known me since I was like, I'm not very tall, but since I was like that. But it was, since I was a little boy, I'd learned the account of David and Goliath. And there were countless times we sang about it, we even acted it out, and if you grew up in church at all, you know this story frontwards and backwards. But this time, when I heard this podcast, I heard something for which years I had never ever thought of before. First Samuel 17, starting at verse 34, and we'll read through verse 37. Verse 34 says, "But David said to Saul, 'Your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it, struck it, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by its hair, struck it, and killed it. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, because he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go, and the Lord be with you. In Bible college, I learned that it's really, really important that we don't grab a particular verse out of Scripture and apply it to whatever you want it to apply to. So this morning, if I could, I just want to give you just a list. It's just some background information about what's going on. It's just a fresh reminder of the story, okay? So number one, David's brothers had been away from home fighting alongside King Saul. Number two, David was a shepherd. King David started out as a shepherd. And he must have been excited to know he was going to go and witness the battle firsthand, to be with his older brothers. Number three, when David arrived at the scene, Scripture says he first did what his father had asked, then went straight to his brothers, which were on the battlefield. Number four, David then heard and saw a great giant taunting not only the Israelites, but also the living God. Number five, after all this, he made his inquire about the reward to whomever defeats the great giant. Number six, his brother then rebukes him, even questioning his heart. But David does stand up for himself. And he says, can't I even speak? And number seven, Saul, he hears about it. And then David presents his plan. Number eight, David is once again questioned, this time by the king of Israel. And the king says, you are just a young man with little to no knowledge of battle. And this giant called Goliath, he's a seasoned warrior. And you don't have a chance. I've never faced a literal giant. I remember being bullied at school, on the football field, where there were bigger men than me. I remember seeing others being taunted by superiors. But never have I stepped out and asked to slay a giant. Or have I? Or have you? When was the last time you faced a giant in your life? For some of us here today, we're facing serious giants. Serious. Some of us in here today are facing emotional giants. Depression, anxiety. Some of us in here have recently lost loved ones. How about relational conflict? Family issues? On the brink of divorce? Maybe it's an addiction to something? Or how about a financial crisis? The loss of a job? The list of giants we are facing today, they are endless. And by our own strength, they seem impossible to overcome. And trust me, for some of you, I can feel your pain. I understand. And God does understand. If you think David wasn't at all terrified, I want you to know you're dead wrong. Because he was. He might have been poised on the outside, but I can guarantee he must have had his doubts. But what David possessed wasn't courage in his own strength, but a courage and an assurance from God. And that's why we see him speaking to the king, King Saul, with such a boldness. And boy, it must have been bold. Imagine being called by the king of Israel and being a lowly shepherd boy. For me, that would have been terrifying enough. Then to have the nerve to boldly remind the king of just what a shepherd's job is. It must have been decades since King Saul had ever thought about the job of a shepherd boy. And it was with this great reminder that King Saul, he allows David to face the impossible. But I think David's words weren't just for the king. They were also for him. And today they're for us. I want you to remember the last time you faced a giant in your mind. For me, talking it through with others has helped me. It's given me the courage and the accountability to get the job done, to walk through the fire, to break down the wall, to break loose of the chains, to face whatever challenge comes my way. Which brings us back to our initial thought. God often uses our past experiences to help us face our future giants. He helps us remember our past. He helps us remember the lion and the bear. The past 7+ years has presented many challenges, mountains, and great giants. I have a list here that I want to share with you. Number one, shifting our family to a foreign land. Number two, starting a school with little to no experience at all. I need you to understand that I have never been a big fan of children. That's true. And I was never really in a good school. Leave that right there. Choosing the right team. Not knowing how God would provide. The grind of living in a culture not your own. Continuing to trust people and God. Having to make hard calls. Learning to say no to the good things so we could say yes to a great thing. Expanding territory, missing loved ones, questioning yourself, your abilities, and finally, questioning God. There was a moment in time I remember questioning God a great deal. You see, every year we have teams that come back and forth from the States, from churches. And this particular trip that I'm going to tell you about, it was a student-led trip. It was about a year and a half ago. And on every single trip that we have, every single group that comes over, we have a fun day. And in that particular fun day, one of the experiences that our groups get to have is going to the source of the Nile River. And that's in Jinja. It's a beautiful, beautiful place. And it's so beautiful. I said, God, it would be really cool to baptize my three daughters there. And man, praise the Lord. Like God, he allowed that to happen. That was a selfish prayer of mine. But thank God and amen for that. It was fun. But with this particular group, we were coming back from Jinja. So we were done for the day. And school was being let out. It was about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Children were going their way. And my buddy Dickie, if you remember on the screen, you saw me. I like to run with a good friend of mine. I like to run with him because if there's ever any problems, he's there. And he was driving the van in the front. He was driving the students. And a couple of my daughters were with the students as well. And I was tailing them in my car driving. And we're going about 70 kilometers an hour. And we're about an hour and a half. We're based in Kampala, and Jinja's about an hour and a half away. And we had just begun the journey on the highway. And all of a sudden, a little girl darts out in front of the van. And literally within a blink of an eye, this little girl knocked the van, and we knocked her. And she flew up and did like 2 cartwheels in the air. Like I can visually see it. And I remember when she came back down and she not only hit the ground, but she also hit the car a second time. And she lay like this, right in the middle of the road. And blood was coming out of her ear. And when we stopped, and I looked at her, I saw a little girl whose life was gone. Mind you, we had students in the van. Mind you, they have parents that weren't with them. I just want you to just think about that moment. What do you do? And by the way, mob justice is a real thing in Uganda. What I mean by that is, if you hit somebody on the street, even accidentally, doesn't matter if it's their fault or your fault, they will mob you and they will kill you. I was scared for Dickie, my buddy. I was scared for us. I was just flat out scared. We took this little girl and we took her to the hospital. They did some tests. We had to go to the police station to explain what happened. We were at that police station until past dark, and it doesn't get dark at 5 o'clock there like it does right now here. It gets dark there about 7:30. We were there for some time. We were at that police station for a couple of hours, and all of a sudden I see this Boda, and it's this little motorcycle, and it's a way of transport around these cities. And this little motorcycle is driving, and I see a man on it, and I see a little girl on it, and something was covering her head, so I couldn't really recognize who it was. And as they approached and they got closer to the police station, that lifeless girl was alive. friends, she was not knocked out. I've seen knocked out people. She was dead. Amen. I'm going to tell you why she's alive today. These students prayed. In that van, they prayed and 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 they prayed. And I know it's because of their prayers and the God that we serve that can bring a dead girl to life. Let me tell you, we weren't satisfied with that hospital, so we took her to another one just to make sure. And we did scans, and that complete, like full body scans. And she had no internal bleedings, no broken bones. The only little thing that happened to her, if you can believe it or not, is a little butterfly stitch that happened right here. That's it. I believe in God, and I believe in miracles. But after that day, my belief in God and my belief in miracles changed forever. And I'm telling you, God, that day, he turned tragedy into testimony. And that is the story of the cross. Amen? Amen. Most people aren't so fortunate. That's a fact. Last night I received a phone call from one of our leaders. His name is Solomon. It's a good name for a leader, yeah? Amazing man. And he calls me. Mind you, it's a 9-hour difference, time difference. And so it's about 1 o'clock in the morning there. And if you are, well, if you're anybody and you get a call at midnight, you know it's probably not good. And I got a call that one of our teachers, one of our beloved teachers, his name is Teacher Daddy. David's his name. Just passed away last night. Just like that. Gone. Left behind Mama Harriet, which she's one of our mothers. Left behind 4 children. In fact, the youngest one is turning 1 this month. All their children, minus the little one, are attending FNC. Praise the Lord. But Teacher Daddy, he's not with us anymore. But I am so confident that he is with Jesus right now, because he showed me Jesus. I want you to know. I remember him saying to me, Todd, I love you. And anything you ask me to do, I will do. And he did. He really, really did. Can we pray for that family right now? God, I want to ask that you would be with Mama Harriet and the children. I also pray, Lord, that you would be with our FNC staff and our FNC family. Lord, I know that I know that you are on your throne no matter what. But Father, we are grieving, and I'm just really thankful, Lord, that I'm able to be in the presence of believers today. And Father, that I know that our prayers are right now, they're lifting up and they're uniting and they are blessing and they are powerful and they work and you listen and you move. And so Father, I thank you for the testimony of Teacher Daddy. I thank you for his life. I thank you that he showed me Jesus. And God, I know that there's going to be great things to come, even through this tragedy. It's because of you that I pray. Amen. Today, FNC faces we face another mountain, and that's the building of a school. Raise your hand if you've ever been a part of building something before. It could be a house, it could be a church, it could be a school, it could be a snow fort, I don't know. A school which has and continues to bring hope to hopeless children. Real hope. And God has, He's expanded our territory, and we have and continue to remember our lions and our bears. And this morning, it's tough to transition into something like this, but I got to show it to you, okay? I got to show you what God's doing. And I hope you saw that through the video. I hope you heard that through the message this morning. And I hope that the hope that we talked about today, hope that that's spilling over into you. Hope that you have that. But can I share with you briefly what God has done and what He's doing and what we know He's going to do? All right. Deb, thank you. Deb's awesome, huh?
Yes.
And Jim. And Jerry. I knew I wouldn't get that right. Jerry, fantastic. So I mentioned that God had, we searched for this land long and hard, and it's tough to buy land no matter where you're at. But I got to tell you, when you're in a developing country, it's not impossible. Because here it is, but like it's almost impossible. The challenges are just they're crazy. I won't go into them right now. But this is just a small glimpse of the blessing that God gave us, and it's 13 plus acres of land. And that doesn't seem like a very big piece of land. I understand, especially being in Iowa right now, where you've just got acres and acres and acres everywhere. But for us. And the compounds that we have our schools in Kampala, which is less than a half an acre, this is enormous. And so, so this is the chunk of land that God has blessed us with. And I want you to know, land in Uganda is not free. And God raised the money for it, and it's paid for already. But He raised $126,000 to buy this land. And not only did He do that, we were able to raise even more money on top of that to build a well because we needed water, right? So we drilled a well. It was really cool. Never done that before. And we put an electric pump down there. And now our kids have like awesome, clean, fresh water. Yeah, it's awesome. And no joke, 2 months after we bought the property, I can't make this up. Electricity came to the property. Like we didn't ask for it. It just came. It was the coolest thing. And there's another little story there, but I don't have time. Yes, Deb, if you want to continue. I wish I could tell you that's done. But man, it looks really nice, doesn't it? Yeah, if I had a little pointer thing, I would show you where all this stuff is. And the well is that centerpiece there where the big building is and the little circular thing. That's the current well right now today. But this is a rendering. I told you guys we partner with a group called EMI, Engineering Ministries International, and they came in and they helped us make plans on this particular piece of property. Deb, if we can go to the next scene. This right here just kind of gives you a breakdown of, we bought the land, just so you know, we were able to use it the first year. That's pretty cool. When I say be able to use it, like they had some existing buildings on there, and so we did a little TLC work, which we love to do anyway. But this time we were able to do it. Because have you ever leased something and you like, you know, you do all this work to, maybe not do all this work, but you do work, right? You paint, you do little things and you're leasing it. And you're like, man, it's not mine, but I'm going to do it anyway. But like, the Lord gave this to us. So we were able to like to, every single thing that we were. And then have you ever like bought a home? And then like you start to do things, you're like, yeah, like, you know what? Like now I can like, now when I paint this, now when I like invest in this, now when I build this, like it's what? It's mine, isn't it? Well, it's God's, but it's, yeah, right? It's cool. Let's go to the next one. So we started like kind of a soft launch as far as fundraising. And we, when I say soft launch, I mean really soft, as in like we like word of mouth just kind of told some people, hey, we're beginning. And this block right here is two classrooms, and on this side is a small guardhouse, and each classroom is 30 students per classroom. And you're going to see some plans on that in a second. This is paid for in full. Done. Deb, next one. Thank you. This is classroom block number two. Again, 30 students, paid for, done. Amen? Yeah. I'm kind of excited about it. This is the inside of one of the classrooms. I love this. I like exposed brick. I don't know if any of you like that or not, but we use brick and mortar in Uganda, and we decided to make a highlight wall, and so, man, this is, we can be creative, and so we did, and I'm just so excited that our kids aren't going to be squeezed anymore. And they're going to have ample room, you know, to learn, and to learn well. So this is the inside of one of the classrooms. This is a drawing of the classroom, and we've got, obviously, we've got a lot more classrooms to build, yeah? And then the next one, this is just a rendering of some future classrooms that I know God is going to do. And then the next one, Deb, awesome. Let's stop here. So, by the way, time-wise, what do I got?
You like how we're all telling you.
Thanks. Okay. Student housing, guys, in Uganda, boarding school is a big deal. It's a big deal because parents literally aren't able to really afford to have their kids at home and go to school. Usually it's like, it's kind of one or the other. I know it kind of sounds weird, but that's how it works. But with boarding school, we're able to, if you will, it's like going to college, okay? And it's three meals a day, it's 365 days a year, but it's most of the days out of the year. We take care of these kids and they need a place to live. And right now with the structures that we have, they're completely full this year. Right now we have 60 children out there on this property. And this year we need to accomplish this structure here that you see. This structure here that you see is actually going to hold 50 students with real toilets and real showers. And you guys are like, that's not a big deal. Trust me, it's a big deal, okay? Flushable toilets and showers are awesome. We can say an amen there. Yeah, and then in the middle there is actually, I just talked about Teacher Daddy. That's where Teacher Daddy and Mama Harriet were going to live. That's where Mama Harriet will definitely live. And we gotta figure something else out. But that is our parents' quarters. Guys, this is our need for this year. I'm letting you know. And the cost of that particular, not quite all of it, but the cost of it actually is about $75,000. I want you to remember, it's $50,000 for 50 children. But that's not for 1 year, guys. That's for like a lot of years. I'm hoping like decades and decades and decades. Church, you guys have blessed us like crazy. Just having us here is awesome. out there, there's some children that still need your help. And by the way, those of you that are already doing that, thank you. Thank you for bringing hope to that child. But we still have some children that need that. And if that would be on your heart to help, that'd be great. The coffee out there, oh shoot, it's gone. Sorry. I apologize. Hey, I just want to say thank you very much from the bottom of my heart for having us here this morning. Nathan, thanks for letting me have this today. And church leaders, elders, all of you, you guys are great. And God is good. And thank you for loving on us. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for today. I thank you for just showing up. I thank you, God, that you bring peace. And man, a world that needs it. And Father, this morning I pray that we remember, as we're facing those giants in our life, that we remember the lion and the bear. That we remember, Lord, the times that you have slayed the giants in our past. Fill us with your hope. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Real quick, I want to remind you, I'm going to have these guys come up. We got to do this first service. I'd like to do it again. So, yellow ones, why don't you guys come on up, all of you. We're going to pray. So I'm going to have you guys, whoever would like to, before we leave and we're deployed, I'm going to have you guys come up. We're going to pray over these guys. Also, just a reminder, if you have it on your heart to give to FNC in this ministry, there's a box back there. See the big ugly bald guy holding it up? Right there. Right. Don't let that be a deterrent.
Right here. Ho, ho. Write the check to NLCC, and in the memo, put FNC.
FNC. Okay, yep. Y'all hear that? If you want to write a check, NLCC, memo, FNC. I'm going to invite whoever wants to come up and pray over these guys to come on up. And we're going to pray and close this way. But let's do this as a church family as well. Let's pray. Father, again, we praise you for this time together. And, for first service, for this service, Father, as we just gather together to pray. And I say amen to Todd. This is a powerful time when we can pray together in agreement. And Father, that you listen and that you move. And, man, thank you. Thank you for that. And we just pray a blessing over these guys, over FNC and the ministry, all the teachers there, all the kids. In this ministry, Lord, that you continue to lead them, give them the strength, give them wisdom, give them discernment, all the decisions that need to be made, Father, for your glory and for your kingdom's sake. We thank you so much for all that's happened in the last 7 years. It's incredible, and we know that you get all the glory for that, bringing in the right people, and the right time, the right place. God, help for us to remember it's all in your timing, especially when we're in a hurry, which we are always. Thank you for such a great reminder this morning. Father, we lift up again this family who's lost a father, a husband, and his teachers. Be with them, Lord, and minister to their hearts. And we pray that you get glory through what happens, God, that this will be a time to be a witness to your awesomeness and the hope that we have in you and the future that we have in you. So, Father, as a church family worldwide, we just want to pray a blessing on these guys and a blessing on FNC. Lord, that you continue to bless them. We just pray these things in your name. Amen. 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 Thanks, guys. You're all deployed. If you have any questions, grab these guys out at their table.